Greetings, fellow browsers of the interwebs. Tis I, shinobiflare, with my second gaming vlog. I promised at the end of the last one that this vlog would be all about Golden Sun, and I'm man of my word. So here's a look back at two of the most underrated games I've ever played. Now, some of you out there may be wondering what exactly Golden Sun is. It's actually an RPG that was released a while back in the form of two Game Boy Advance games, Golden Sun and the sequel, Golden Sun The Lost Age. A while back I was lent the first game by a friend, but you already know the story of my sordid history with Golden Sun 1 from my tribute video I released a while back. Now, I'm going to get to the actual story. I'll try not to spoil anything, but here goes. The plot of Golden Sun 1 centers around a young boy named Isaac and his best friend, Garrett. They also have another friend named Jenna, but I'll get to her role in a minute. Isaac and Garrett live in a village called Vale, which apparently was built to guard a mountain known as Mount Aleph, which is close to Alpha, because that's supposedly where the origin of all alchemy came from. I'll explain about alchemy in a bit. Anyway, one day there's a terrible storm, and this huge boulder comes hurtling down from the top of the mountain. That's when we first see that the people in this village, especially older people, possess a strange power known as synergy, spelled with a silent P in front as in psychic. It's a hybrid of magic and psychic energy because it projects things from the user's mind, allowing them to do various things from lifting boulders to pushing pillars with invisible hands, exactly the way Isaac pushes your enemies off the stage in Brawl when he's using an assist trophy. Similar to Pokemon, you're going to need to unlock various abilities in order to progress through certain parts of the game. Thankfully, the moves are also permanently learned. You get items which teach you essential abilities like Catch to grab things that are out of reach, and you can switch them to any character you want. Now, all of this may sound a bit complicated to you if you've never played the game, but trust me when I say that it's easy to go with the flow. Anyway, the boulders are hurtling down from the mountain, and the village elders are basically trying to slow it down with their synergy so everyone can escape. But unfortunately, it's not working, and the entire village has to be evacuated. Unfortunately, Jenna's brother, Felix, has fallen into the river, and Isaac's father is trying to help him. Isaac and Garrett go for help, but by the time they arrive, it's too late. Isaac's father and Felix are swept down the river, presumably dead. And to make matters worse, just after that happens, Isaac and Garrett get into a fight with two mysterious people. And defying all RPG conventions, this first fight is one that you lose. There's absolutely no way to win. You're just that underleveled and there's no way to train up during this first part. Anyway, after you lose, you get knocked out, and Isaac and Garrett, due to this, start training their synergy so they can become stronger in order to prevent something like this from repeating again. 3 years pass, and Isaac, Garrett, and Jenna have become a lot stronger. Apparently, they've been training with this old guru-type guy called Crayton, rhymes with Raiden, and for some reason, despite the fact that it's been 3 years since the incident, only just now has Crayton decided to go and investigate what went wrong on that fateful day. So he drags Jenna, Isaac, and Garrett along, since they are, after all, the main characters, but guess who they run into? Yes, but thankfully you don't fight them this time. They just let you go by for some reason.
I don't know, just go with it. The game gets a lot better after this, trust me.
Anyway, inside the temple at the top of the mountain, Soul Sanctum, you solve a simple puzzle that involves, for the first time, using your move synergy to move statues into place, leading to a secret portal.
Now, before you enter this portal right now, you should give all of Jenna's equipment, and I mean all of it, back to Isaac and Garrett. Just trust me on this one.
Once you've done that, the portal warps you to what the temple was meant to guard, the four elemental stars, symbols of the four elements and the power they hold. Unfortunately, Sarturos and Minardi, the two powerful magicians you fought before, along with a mysterious man in a mask, foreshadowing, show up, and basically kidnap Jenna and Crayton, requesting that you bring the elemental stars to them, and then they'll give them back. You're about to deliver them, and you get all but one of them, the Mars Star, delivered to them by their companion, Alex, when all of a sudden the chamber you're in starts to collapse, but not before the man in the mask reveals himself to be Felix!
But wait, you say, isn't Felix supposed to be dead? Well, as it turns out, the game actually faked us out. Sarturos and Minardi saved Felix from the river further on down where the current took him, and now he's fighting against Isaac and Garrett.
What a twist! So the bad guys escape with Jenna and Creighton in tow, and say goodbye to Jenna because we won't be seeing her again until the ending.
Yeah, seriously. That's why I had you give all her equipment to Isaac and Garrett, because at least this way you can at least sell it or get some use out of it. See, there is a method to my madness after all.
Anyway, you escape with the Mars Star in tow, thanks to another mystical being called the Wise One, who looks like a rock with a face.
Yeah, that's really uncreative.
And then Mount Elif erupts.
Apparently the dormant volcano didn't take too kindly to having its rock stolen.
And this is when your quest begins in earnest. As Isaac and Garrett, your goal is to go around the world and stop the bad guys from lighting the four elemental lighthouses that, when lit, it seems, will unleash the full threat of alchemy on the Earth.
Alchemy is apparently synonymous with synergy in this game, so why they actually invented the new term synergy for the game when alchemy works just as well is beyond me.
The quests that you go through range from tedious to actually very fun as you go from town to town, and along the way you'll pick up two more party members, making up the full traditional four-member party. The first you'll meet is Ivan. He's relatively young, but he's a Jupiter adept, which is very rare. He uses wind-based magic as well as thunder-based, which kind of makes sense when you consider that Jupiter is the god of storms, too. But what's really cool is he has some of the stereotypical psychic abilities, including seeing things you couldn't normally see with Reveal, and even reading minds. The only problem is that he sucks as a regular attacker, but his speed is really high, which is nice. The other party member you'll gain is Mia. She's a Mercury adept, which means her attacks are all water and ice-based. Mia's magic defense is really high, but the problem is she doesn't do as much damage as she should. So yeah, essentially she's the designated healer of the group.
Now, why is it that a lot of the time in video games the designated healer is usually a woman? However, the next game makes up for it.
The game's battle system is phenomenal. Picture Final Fantasy's traditional turn-based attack system. Now imagine that with fully animated attack sequences, three-dimensional graphics, amazing music, and cool-looking spells to boot, all on the Game Boy Advance, and you've got yourself Golden Sun's battle system. Except for one added wrinkle I failed to mention before. Scattered all over the planet are 32 magical beings known as the Elemental Genii. For each gen that travels with you, your character's stats will be enhanced for each gen they equip. And each gen is one of the four elemental types. In other words, equipping more gen of the same element to one character will make them much stronger.
But wait, there's more!
Switching around the genii can actually change your character's classes and give them different abilities. And trust me when I say that mastering that concept is crucial to advancing. Also, gen can affect the way you fight in battle too, and here's how. When you unleash an elemental genie, it will result in a different effect. Some of them will just have a high-powered attack that hits one enemy, but others form shields, increase a single stat, or even recover hit points, which is really cool. These little guys will come in handy a lot during these battles, but that's nothing compared to what you can do after you've unleashed them. See, after you unleash a genie, it goes into standby mode, which will then allow you to perform a summoning.
And I can just hear everyone screaming that Golden Sun is a Final Fantasy ripoff, but trust me when I say that Bahamut is nowhere to be found. Which may or may not be a good thing.
Anyway, the first game didn't go too far with this concept. Despite the fact that at the maximum each of the four characters will have 8 gen equipped, there are only 4 different summons for each element, levels 1 through 4. As you probably already guessed, the summon strength will vary depending upon the number of gens you have stockpiled. The strongest, level 4, all have the coolest attack animations, and since it would take too long to talk about all 4 levels, I'll just go with the strongest ones. For Isaac, you get Judgment, who looks suspiciously like Omnimon from Digimon. But anyway, he fires this strange-looking beam from his shield that causes this huge DBZ-style explosion. That's badass! Then there's Garrett's. Rather than being an actual deity, Garrett's just cuts the bullshit and drops a fucking meteor on them.
Shut up! We already have enough people screaming ripoff on the internet. We don't need any more.
Anyway, getting back to the summons, we then have Ivan's level 4 summoning, the Norse god of thunder himself, Thor. He basically shoots a huge shitstorm of lightning, then disappears. Basic stuff, but it's still pretty cool looking.